Alright, everybody, we finally caught up with the present for one final WrestleMania Wednesday. And I'm happy to say it was a pretty awesome one. For the most part.
You're watching SOAP! This is Freddy Krueger saying hi!
Hey everybody, welcome to WrestleMania Wednesday. I'm your host Don, and today we're going to talk about WrestleMania 33, which just aired on April 2nd, last Sunday, in Orlando, Florida. This was a pretty darn good WrestleMania. I've got a few quibbles, some complaints, there were some duds. Halfway through the show, I was ready to call this the greatest WrestleMania of all time. That is how strong the first half was. That was how amazing those matches were. Even the pre-show was the greatest pre-show of all time. But then it kind of stumbled a little bit. The main event itself, which we'll get to, had some problems. But ultimately, it ended on such an amazing... I don't want to say high note, I don't want to say low note. It ended on such an amazing moment that it pulled it all together for me. It's not the greatest WrestleMania of all time, as I was hoping it would be. But I think it's got to be in the conversation for top 10, maybe top 15. And we're going to do something that we've never done here on WrestleMania Wednesday. We're going to talk about the pre-show. So this might run a little long. I've never talked about the pre-show before because I've been re-watching them. And the WWE Network, which I love, $9.99 a month, and I recommend it highly for any wrestling fans out there. It's not the easiest thing to navigate, especially not on the Xbox One, which is where I've been watching the WrestleManias. So I'd have to watch two separate But I did watch this one, and the matches were really, really good. And not even that they were good, they were important. And they were so good and so important that they should have been a part of the main show. So I'm just going to consider this all WrestleMania. The pre-show opened with the Cruiserweight Championship on the line. It was champion Neville versus Austin Aries. This was awesome. This was great. I'm not a huge 205 Live fan. I watched the Cruiserweight Championship, what was it, last year? And it was awesome. And then the Cruiserweights went on Raw, and it was okay, but it felt out of place. So then they gave them their own show, 205 Live, and the talents are so great, but, like, the writing is just wacky, and it's just one more wrestling show that I just don't have time to watch. But this was a really good match. Neville has really come into his own as a heel. He's a villain now. He used to be just kind of a generic babyface. But now he's a really awesome, evil jerk. And Austin Aries is just a quality wrestler. It's good to see him out of NXT, you know, stepping up. Although he's kind of... I don't know if NXT to 205 is really a step up or if it's just like a lateral move. But anyway, good for him. Neville retained. But Austin Aries put in a great show. And he'll definitely be champion someday. He'll probably be heavyweight champion someday. Then we go on to the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. This one was kind of weird. Big Show, who I think he came out and said this was his last WrestleMania, isn't even really on WrestleMania. It's just the pre-show. And he got eliminated almost immediately. Him and Braun Strowman, who were the two picks to really win it. It ended up being Mojo Rawley, who I do like. He's a fun guy. He's a cool guy. He won with the help of some football player who's his friend in real life, apparently. I wrote his name down because I don't know football. I don't watch football. I don't care about football. No offense to anybody. Rob Gronkowski of the Patriots. Technically, that was cheating, but it was still fun. And I like Mojo. It's fun to see him get a win. And he wins that stupid trophy. And then in a shocking turn of events, the Intercontinental title was defended on the pre-show. Nobody expected that. I think that must have been some weird last-minute decision. So Dean Ambrose, champion, defending against Baron Corbin in a really good match. Arguably the greatest pre-show match of all time. When has the Intercontinental title ever not been defended on WrestleMania? Weird. But anyway, this was a fun match, which I can't help but think would have been a little more intense, and the wrestlers might have been a little more into it had it been on the main show instead of the pre-show. But these are two great wrestlers, two of my favorite wrestlers currently in the company. I love Dean Ambrose. I see a lot of potential in Baron Corbin. Dean Ambrose retains the title. The ending was amazing. Baron Corbin was going to put Dean into his finisher, which I think is called the End of Days, where he takes people and he throws them around into some kind of weird DDT. But while he threw them around, Dean Ambrose did like a front flip and then turned it into his finisher, the Dirty Deeds. I didn't know Dean Ambrose was capable of that kind of athleticism. It was really impressive, and it was really fun. And it was a great finisher to a really good match. The pre-show is streamed live on YouTube, so I could kind of, it's kind of maybe a compliment to these guys that they put them on the pre-show, because that was the match that was they were hoping would hook people in so they would pay to watch WrestleMania and to pay the $9.99 for the network. So in a way, maybe it was a compliment moving them to the pre-show. I don't know. But anyway, it was a really cool match. And then we go into the main show itself. WrestleMania, the ultimate thrill ride, as they kept calling it. Hosted by The New Day. They don't have any matches. They're just the host. And by that, remember when I think The Rock is hosted? Hogan hosted. Have they had other hosts? The hosts, they show up, they do a little monologue, and then maybe they appear one more time. It's kind of like if you host the Oscars, you give the monologue, and then you never get seen again. And then we go into the opening match, AJ Styles versus Shane McMahon. Nobody really expected this match to be that amazing. We've got AJ Styles, who is arguably the greatest wrestler in the world today. One of the greatest wrestlers of all time. He's an amazing showman and an amazing technical wrestler. And then we've got Shane, who does lots of spots and crazy stunts. People felt let down, myself included, because they wanted AJ Styles to fight another great wrestler. But boy, were we wrong. This match was awesome. This was the match of the night, in my opinion. One of the matches of the year contender, for sure. I might owe an apology to Shane, because in my previous WrestleMania Wednesday review of 32, I said some disparaging things about his match with The Undertaker. I said it was fun, but I said these two at this point aren't really wrestlers. Undertaker's too old, and Shane McMahon is just more of a stuntman than a wrestler. But boy, was I wrong. He's a wrestler. He did some amazing mat chain wrestling, awesome submission holds, great striking. He was great. It was just an amazing match. I was blown away. My expectations were low, but even if my expectations were high, I think it would have exceeded my expectations. It was just so much fun, and both guys were just amazing. So props to Shane. He did it. AJ was not carrying him at all. Like, these guys were both giving it their all and just put on a great show. It was great. AJ Styles won as well. He should. But props to Shane, who was really great. Then we go right into the match for the U.S. Championship as champion Chris Jericho defending against former best friend Kevin Owens. This one was, I was really looking forward to this one. The feud going into it was a lot of fun. One of the best feuds of all time, in my opinion. Up there with the Hatfields-McCoy situation. It was just a really great match. Two amazing wrestlers putting on a great show. I'm not going to say it was either their best match. This was not the match of the night. But it was really great and really fun. And Kevin Owens prevailed. I didn't expect that. I thought Jericho was the hero in the wronged party, so I thought he would get his comeuppance, but great match. Liked it a lot. Then we have a fatal four-way elimination match for the Raw Women's Championship. That's a mouthful. We've got champion Bayley in her WrestleMania debut against Nia Jax in her WrestleMania debut versus Charlotte versus Sasha Banks. This one was pretty awesome as well. In my last episode, I said the triple threat match between Charlotte, Sasha Banks, and Becky Lynch was the greatest female wrestling match of WrestleMania history, but I think this one's better. Maybe not. I don't know. But this one was as good, probably. I really liked it. It was just a lot of fun. I really liked the way they used Nia Jax, who was just huge. The biggest and most intimidating female wrestler since China. Possibly even more intimidating than China. She's just ridiculous. But in a good way. I like her a lot. And I love how they got rid of her, because they had all the other three women team up on her, and then they all piled up on her and pinned her. So she was out. And then Charlotte pinned Sasha Banks, so Sasha Banks was out. So then it was just up to Bayley and Charlotte. And Bayley won in a tribute to the Macho Man. She did she dropped the Macho Man elbow and got a clean win. And it was a really good match. Good for Bayley. Then let's check in with the Hall of Fame class of 2017. We've got DDP, Diamond Dallas Page, Rock and Roll Express, Teddy Long, Ravishing Rick Rude, posthumously, Beth Phoenix, and Kurt Angle. Quality. All of these people are more than deserving. All these people probably should have been in years ago. Then we have a ladder match for the Raw Tag Team Championship. This was supposed to be a six-man tag team match with three tag teams. But then the New Day came out and they said it's actually going to be four teams. And everybody thought of the New Day were going to enter themselves into the match. But then they revealed that the Hardy Boys were in there, which explains why it's a ladder match, because they're famous for their acrobatics and their daring do at ladder matches in WrestleMania history. The crowd went absolutely insane. The Hardy Boys, who we haven't seen in WWE, 10 years? Something like that. They have been making a huge splash as the broken Hardy Boys or whatever going on in like TNA or Impact or whatever, wherever they've been. I haven't seen any of it, but everybody talks about it, about how they've been amazing. And they're a little older. They're a little fatter, at least Matt is. But boy, they're still great. They could still go like they were in their 20s. They're probably older than me, I don't know, or as old as me, which is old. I'm ancient. But it was great. It was just an amazing match. Everybody was good. Oh yeah, who else was in it? Enzo and Big Cass, Sheamus and Cesaro, and Gallows and Anderson, who were the champions. The Hardy Boys won. The Hardy Boys came back after a decade and won the titles. It was really, really fun. Every team got their spots in and did really well. And this this was an epic, epic match. I loved it. It was great. Good to see the Hardy Boys back. Next up is The Miz and Maryse versus John Cena and Nikki Bella in a mixed, I don't remember how they refer to it. It's one of those, it's man and a woman versus man and a woman, but the men fight the men, the women fight the women. Which is great. It's fine. But Lucha Underground was just put on Netflix, so I've been watching that, and they have men fighting women. I'm not saying WWE should do that, but maybe they should do it. I don't know. That would be kind of cool. Nikki Bella versus The Miz. I don't know. I think Nikki Bella could hold her own. She's a tough-looking woman. Anyway, this one was pretty good. It wasn't amazing. It was really short, but The Miz was great in it. The Miz was just, he's the best heel in the company. He's one of the best heels of all time. He was just getting the crowd going. The build-up to this one was great. Like, for the past few weeks, it was basically The Miz and Maryse making fun of John Cena and Nikki Bella, saying they're not really in love. They're fake. They play to the cameras. And it was just a lot of fun. And The Miz and Maryse are hilarious and really talented, as are John Cena and Nikki Bella. I like all four of these. John Cena and Nikki Bella win. They dominate. And then John Cena proposes to Nikki Bella. Then he pulls out the biggest diamond ring I've ever seen. It was amazing. And she says yes, and they both cry, and the crowd cries, and I'm crying, and everybody's crying, and it's a beautiful moment, and it felt genuine. However, and I don't want to poo-poo on their beautiful moment, because it was beautiful. It was genuinely moving and touching and beautiful. However, during the build-up to this match over the past few weeks and months, The Miz would made the claim, the accusation that John Cena was just pretending to love Nikki Bella for the cameras. Like, they would have a spoof of the Total Bellas reality show where they would they'd show the Miz dressed as John Cena saying, "I love you, Nikki," and then they would show like a guy holding a cue cards that say, "I love you, Nikki." So having John Cena propose on camera at WrestleMania kind of doesn't that just prove the Miz's point? That he's just playing out for the cameras and trying to get attention? I don't know. But anyway, it was a nice moment and really sweet and good for them. They do seem like they're in love. And when he proposed to her, he didn't say, "Will you marry me, Nikki?" He said, "Will you marry me, whatever her real name is." I thought that was a nice touch. Then we go into an unsanctioned match between Triple H and Seth Rollins. This was another one that had an amazing build-up. This was like a two-year-long build-up for this one. This, on a pure technical level, this was probably the best Triple H WrestleMania match. But I think I enjoyed his match from 31 with Sting more, just because it was more fun. This one was just a straight-up wrestling match. It went on a little too long, as Triple H matches tend to do. But I love Seth Rollins. You can't have a bad... Seth Rollins has never had a bad match. If he's in the ring, I'm there, and I'm enthralled, and I'm having fun. This was a really good match. Seth Rollins just elevated it, and it was really fun. He just has so much energy, and he's such a good wrestler. I loved it. It was fun, yeah. So last year, Triple H lost to Roman Reigns. This year, he lost to Seth Rollins. So next year, he has to lose to the third member of the Shield, Dean Ambrose, theoretically. And Stephanie McMahon has to get hurt in some way. That's been the pattern. All right, and then we go into the match for the WWE Championship. It's champion Bray Wyatt defending against Randy Orton. This is where things started to take a downward turn. This isn't a terrible match by any means. These are both great wrestlers. This one was just, it was just weird. It was just weird. It was kind of weird and experimental. There was some kind of projector above the ring. So Bray Wyatt acted like he was going to start playing mind games on Randy Orton. So the projector projected like bugs on the ring. Like the camera went to like a bird's eye view. So you saw like Randy Orton in the middle of the ring with like bugs crawling around. It was just really weird and it didn't work. I don't know what they thought. I mean, visually it was a neat idea and it looked kind of neat, but it just was dumb. It just didn't work. I can't even imagine what the people like live saw. They wouldn't even be able to see any of it. It just didn't work. It was dumb. And the whole feud leading up to this, I didn't know who I was supposed to root for. Because I don't know who was the good guy and who was the bad guy. If you haven't been following it, I don't even want to get into it. It's about how Randy Orton felt slighted or something by Bray Wyatt, so he tricked him and he joined the Wyatt family, but then he ended up burning down Bray Wyatt's house, and I don't know. So, I don't know who the good guy was and who was the bad guy, but Randy Orton won, and he's now the new WWE champion, which I like Randy Orton. Some people are complaining about that. I don't care. I think he's really good, and I think it's cool he won again, but I would like to have seen Bray Wyatt have a longer reign as champion, because I was pretty sure it was like a month. But anyway, I don't know. I didn't really have anything invested in this match, and it was just weird and hard to follow. And I couldn't get into it. Then we go into the match for the Universal Championship. It's champion Goldberg, remember him, versus Brock Lesnar. This was that. So Goldberg, again, hasn't been wrestling for what, like 15 years, something like that. So he came back when at SummerSlam and beat Brock Lesnar in under 2 minutes. Spear, jackhammer, pin. Minute and a half, something like that. And then they met again in the middle of the Royal Rumble, where Goldberg immediately threw him out of the ring in like a couple seconds. So then this match, nobody knew what to expect. I had no idea what to expect. Is Goldberg going to win again in 2 minutes? Is Brock going to beat him in 2 minutes? I think the overall time was like 5 minutes. Brock kicked his ass. But Goldberg put in a pretty decent defense. There was some back and forth. Goldberg was great. Like, he just got the crap kicked out of him. And he's an old man. I mean, he still looks amazing, but he's an old man, and he took, like, 10 suplexes, I think, is what he took, landing on your back over and over again, and Brock is a big, tough guy. Anyway, I really like this one. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't think there'd be that much wrestling, and there wasn't. I think the only moves, literally the only moves we saw were spears from Goldberg, a couple spears, I think one jackhammer, a couple F5s from Brock, and then a 10 suplexes. Literally, that's all that happened. But it was fun. It was what it needed to be. 5 minutes of these two. And if it had gone on any longer, it would have gotten boring. If it had been any shorter, it would have been lame. They did pretty good. I liked it. It was fun. So Brock Lesnar is the new Universal Champion. We'll see how that goes. I don't know. Then we go into the six-pack challenge for the SmackDown Women's Champion. It's Alexa Bliss defending her title versus Becky Lynch versus Mickie James versus Carmella with James Ellsworth in her corner versus Natalya versus Naomi. Wow. These are all really good wrestlers. Even Carmella. I like her a lot. I think she's fun. There's just too many of them, and they didn't have enough time to do anything. I think if this match had been 10 or 15 minutes, it would have been great, but I think it was like 5 or 6 minutes. Maybe it was a little bit longer than that. It was just too short and weird, and there's too many people. It was hard to follow. It was just and then it was over. Naomi won, which is great. She was the champion before, but she got a legit like leg injury, so she had to drop the title to Alexa Bliss. Who? Alexa Bliss might, in fact, be my favorite. She's certainly my favorite current female wrestler. She might be my favorite of all time. She's one of my favorite wrestlers of all time. She's just so good, and she's just got so much charisma. She's a great villain. She's arguably the greatest female heel ever. I love her as the champion. She's just like the mean girl at school, making fun of everybody. But I know he's good too. She deserves a win. And the crowd, she's from Orlando, and the Orlando crowd was certainly supportive of their girl. And then we go into the main event, which is The Undertaker versus Roman Reigns. And they bring out Jim Ross, who we haven't seen him in like 10 years either, right? And they bring him out to be a guest commentator. Jim Ross, who has been in the news lately because his wife passed away just, what, like last week? 2 weeks ago? So, props to him for being able to even do it. But I think it was probably good for him, you know, to get back out there. He was a natural. He was right back into it. It was so great hearing his voice again. Because for me, he'll always be, he's the voice. He's the voice of, not just WWE, he's the voice of wrestling. Jim Ross, Jerry Lawler, Jesse Ventura, and Gorilla Monsoon. They're my guys. But Jim Ross is the best of all time. And if you're wondering why this is the main event, when it's not a title match, it's just The Undertaker versus Roman Reigns, it's because, at the end of the day, it looks like, after 25 WrestleManias, after how many years at WWE, after how many decades in wrestling in general, like 30 years, maybe longer, it looks like he's retiring. And that's okay. If you had told me Saturday night that the Undertaker was going to retire, and this would be his last match, I would be distraught. I'd be like, no, you can't do that. WrestleMania needs The Undertaker. He's amazing. He's always going to have it. No. This may have been one WrestleMania too many. He was old, slow, missed a lot of moves. You could really tell Roman Reigns was carrying him and doing his best to make him look great. People can boo Roman Reigns all they want. He was a hero. He was a hero tonight. It was not a great match. It had its moments. It was just you could tell The Undertaker was legit in pain. Just old and tired and slow. He just couldn't do what he used to do. At one point, he was literally the greatest wrestler of all time. He still is the greatest wrestler. He'll always be the greatest wrestler of all time. And I'll be sad to never see him wrestle again. But I was more sad seeing him wrestling past his prime. Not even past his prime, past his past prime. Anyway, so Roman wins, thunderous boos, and then he leaves the ring. So the Undertaker gets up, he puts his jacket and hat back on, and he acts like he's going to leave the ring. Like he goes to the ropes, but then he hesitates, and he comes back to the middle of the ring, and he slowly takes his gloves off and puts them down. Then he takes his trench coat off, folds it up slowly. This all takes like 3 hours. Puts it in the pile in the ring. Then he takes his hat off and leaves it. And he just kind of looks down, and then he turns and he just walks away. And then he walks into the sunset, as it were. So not a great match, but boy, it was a powerful image. And watching The Undertaker basically retire and just move and just leave forever, I forgot about the match at that point. I was just in awe and, you know, almost, you know, misty-eyed. And that it was a perfect way to end his career. I wish his match had been a little bit better, and I wish it had happened maybe 2 years ago. He probably should have retired after the Brock Lesnar thing, done the exact same thing after Brock Lesnar beat him, done the whole thing where he took off the jacket and the hat, because that was perfect. But as it is, I don't know, 25 WrestleMania. So his overall totals were 23 wins, 2 losses. 2 losses to Brock Lesnar and Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns, who I like. I like Roman Reigns a lot. He's one of my favorites. It's going to be weird. Every WrestleMania for the past 25 years, maybe 26, I think he missed one over 26 years. But he's been in 25, which nobody will ever even come close to that. I think the next would be, I think, maybe probably Triple H. I don't know how many he's been in. So yeah, that was WrestleMania 33. A really solid, even great WrestleMania, in my opinion. I thought it was really great. There were a couple duds, and the match with The Undertaker was sad and depressing to see, because he was not the man he was. He was past his prime, and I'm not going to say anything disparaging about him, but he wasn't on the top of his game. That's all I'll say. But the ending was such a powerful moment, and he deserves to retire. Good for him. I hope he rests in peace, but lives. But all in all, kind of a weird WrestleMania. There were no Rock at all. There were no old school guys at all. There were no cameos. No old school guys came out and beat up the new talent, which is good. Because I don't like when the old guys, they come out and beat up the new talent. But I do like to see them. I would have liked to see The Rock at some point. I didn't need a half hour with The Rock. There were no backstage vignettes at all. There were no comedy bits. It was just wrestling. Which is pretty cool. But, you know, I don't know. They could have, could have fit The Rock in there somewhere. I know I can't be. I complain when you give The Rock a half hour, and I complain when there's no Rock. But anyway, all in all, I give this one a thumbs up. Maybe even 2 thumbs up. I thought it was great. But probably skip the Undertaker match. But I don't know. I think even the Undertaker match is worth watching if you want to see just how good Roman Reigns really is. Because he's out there. He was just, you can even see how frustrated he was. He was trying to make the match work. And for the most part, I think he succeeded. Because the match was watchable. It was just, oh! Like, what were they trying to do there? Like, the Undertaker was trying to lift him up and do something, but he didn't, I don't know. Or said, oh, that didn't connect. But anyway. Anyway, that's 33 WrestleMania. I did it. This is my time to take off my metaphorical hat and leave it in the ring and retire. I guess I'll be back next year for WrestleMania 34, wherever that's going to be. Whoever will be in there, God willing, I'll watch it. And God willing, you'll all be here to watch it with me. It's weird. I started this WrestleMania Wednesday thing months ago. And then I got distracted and some other things came up, so I had to stop doing them for like a month or two. And then so randomly, I just started doing it again. And I didn't look at the calendar, but when I came back and started doing it again, it was in perfect sync with the new WrestleMania, WrestleMania 33. It just worked out, like somehow the timing worked out perfectly. So I guess God wanted me to finish WrestleMania Wednesday. Or not. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody, all three of you. That's really all I care about. I just wanted an excuse to rewatch all these WrestleManias that I had missed over the years. And I did. And it was fun. It was hard. It was frustrating. It was boring. It was exciting. It was exhilarating. It was, I laughed. I cried. I hope somebody out there got some kind of enjoyment out of it. And please comment down below if you did. What's your favorite WrestleMania? I thought about maybe coming back next week and doing like a top 10 matches or top 10 something. But I don't think I'm going to. Because I did Google like top 10 matches and they're all the same. And they're all identical to what I would do. The best match was Steamboat, Savage, Hitman, Stone Cold, and The Undertaker, Shawn Michaels. Those were the best matches. But there were so many. And there were too many for me to pick. It was too intimidating. But as it was, I say, go watch WrestleMania 17, 3, 13, 10, and 31. Those are the best, I think. Oh yeah, and if you like indie wrestling, you should watch my giveaway video, which as of right now, April 5th, 2017, is still ongoing. I'm giving away the indie-themed pro wrestling crate. Because I don't know anything about indie wrestling. And I don't want the crate. I want to give it to somebody who will appreciate it and like it more than I would. So watch that video. I'll put a link down in the description if you want to enter that video. Basically, you have to go to that video. You have to subscribe to this page. And then comment with either your favorite wrestler of all time or your favorite match of all time. And then I'm going to randomly choose somebody who commented and send them that pro wrestling crate. And pro wrestling crate is a mystery box full of wrestling shirts and stuff. Large size shirts because I'm a large. Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. And I will see you next year. Or you can watch some of the other videos. We do like Golden Girls reviews and we eat food and watch movies. And anyway, pet dogs. Anyway, I'm going to take my hat off now.